Hi friends, it's Scott, and in this video I'm going to do something slightly different to that I normally do, and it's something I've been wanting to do for a long time, and that is building the same app using both React and TypeScript and also Power Apps. Is it to find a winner? Possibly. Am I going to regret it? Maybe. But let's do this and find out. And this video has been kindly sponsored by Microsoft Canada. Okay, let's level the playing field a little bit. We're going to be building an internal application using Azure Active Directory to authenticate users. And we're not going to do any mobile app shenanigans or public-facing websites. And we're allowing users to view their current weekly schedule and then also allow them to add new events into their calendar. So let's dive into the React part. There's this nifty little utility called Create React App, which basically creates an empty TypeScript React project for me to start with. And then I can run it locally and it refreshes as I save the source files. So I'm just going to use npm start, and then look at that spinning and everything. It's a beautiful piece of design, except we don't need that, so we're going to just like delete all of that code. But what we do need to is authenticate the user against Azure ID. And again, luckily enough, Microsoft have done all the hard work for us, and so we can use the MSL library. And there's even a Microsoft graph sample,
one API to rule them all.
So I can just go to the sample GitHub repo and copy paste all the authentication boilerplate stuff. And I'm using VS Code, which obviously is in dark mode because it makes us look like we're hacking the matrix. And this app is going to retrieve all the calendar events for the authenticated users and allow them to create a new one. So I create a page for each of them. So let's have a go. NPM start, watch. There's something wrong. I didn't copy all of the code that I needed to. So I'm just going to need to go and create an authentication context. So I'll paste that in. Let's try again. Another problem. I need to fix that. So let's go and see how that works. Looking promising, except for I've obviously not read any of the tutorial because I failed to notice that I need an application registering in Azure AD. Your app ID here is a clue. So yeah, my eyes, no dark mode. And I just haven't got time to turn that on. It's registered as a single page application using our local web server as a redirect that will receive both the auth code on the query string after the user logs in. So let's see if that works. You have to give permission for the app to read your calendar data. Woo! Yes, we've logged in. Let's try with a different user. Got those mountains. I can log in and it shows my username. Pretty impressive stuff so far. Meanwhile, over in Power Apps Maker Portal, obviously like a good Power Platform citizen, I'm going to create a solution to hold all my stuff, make it easier to deploy later on. But creating a Canvas app is kind of like using Create React App, except for no spinny things, sad face. And yes, I know, where's the dark mode? We create screens in a similar way as we created the root components in React, and the current user is immediately authenticated, so there's no need to use MSL. It just works, trademark patent pending. And so look there, ta-da! Layout containers are awesome for creating responsive apps, just like HTML divs in React. We can create components in Power Apps that are reusable across multiple pages. But unlike React, however, those components can't contain other components. So each screen just has like a single level of child components. And the top nav in our app is going to be used on all screens. So we're going to create it as a local component. We can also create a reusable components that are shared between all apps in the same environment. And a component library would be similar to importing an NPM React library like we did for React Bootstrap. But this theming story in Canvas app is somewhat more straightforward than React. There's no CSS. We just use the app themes or create custom theme object like I'm doing here to define the semantic colors to use. The thing is, a cousin component can't use the theme that is used in the parent app scope. So we need to create input properties and pass those down to use in the theme in the child components. And this is kind of like props in React, and it can start to get overly complex, just like props in React, especially when we don't need to share the components. So there's this magic setting for local components access app scope. Now we can access the theme from the parent app and also have buttons navigate between screens. So it's a trade-off between reusability and simplicity, I guess. I'll spend loads of times arguing with myself about this, but I never win. But anyway, now I've got it working and we can share out the app to different users who are licensed, of course, but that's a different story. And so just like before, I can see only my data. So let's dive back into the React app then. And the calendar page component needs to show the current week of events. So we use the start of week function from the NPM library date funds. Is it funds or FNs? I'm not sure. But I love that about TypeScript. There's a ton of libraries that you can just do about just about everything that you can easily import using NPM install. And the ecosystem around the shared libraries is just huge. So we create an array of 7 days and output them to the component. Let's see how that looks. Wow, pretty impressive. No, you're not impressed. Okay, well, let's create another component. And this is what makes React so good, is components all manage their own rendering state. So a component for the day cell can be a pure component. That means it doesn't need to re-render unless the day changes. So we create another component to show the day rows. Oh, emoji picker. Can't have enough emojis. But seriously, VS Code has got excellent autocomplete, someone more sophisticated than Power Apps. But unlike Power Apps, React allows you to have components inside other components and pass props all the way down to the grandchildren. And send them money on their birthday. I feel like React CSS styling is easier than Power Apps theming and styling, but maybe that's because I've just been doing this for over 2 decades. So I'll concede that it's not for everyone. And if I haven't had coffee in the morning, it'll throw a tantrum and they'll just be user interface all in the wrong places.
3 hours later.
But it's looking nice right now, so it's worth it. It wasn't that bad, right? Power Apps has a core component called a gallery. Galleries can contain other galleries. So it's kind of like the nested calendar day row and day cell component in the React app. Each day row will need to calculate the height based on the number of events it contains, because we're going to use a child gallery to contain all of those events. PowerFX has got lots of standard Excel date functions built in, like for converting and formatting dates. So the repeating template in the gallery, we add the 3 date labels, then bind the gallery to 7 rows. We can then use the date formatting to display the different date parts. We can then style using the theme like we did before, and then let's add a border to that using a 1-pixel rectangle and use the theme to define the color. Using the stack container layout, we can then also add the header at the top here. Not bad. So the React app had the start of week function, but we don't have that function in PowerFX. But luckily, we can create reusable functions in Power Apps too. We create a component library and add the start of week and end of week functions. And each function can have input parameters, like functions do. They're called pure functions because they don't have any side effects outside of the function itself. And the component library has screens too that allows us to test your function before publishing it. So once we've published and then imported the functions into the calendar app, we can use that instance to use the different functions. It would be great if we could have an equivalent to NPM to import components like this. There is AppSource, but it's difficult to get a component in there due to it being somewhat bureaucratic. But look here, we have a gallery of days just like we had in React. The MSL library for React has a component that will only show content if the user is authenticated, which is really handy. And this isn't needed in Power Apps because it just won't let you in the front door until you're authenticated. Each React component has state, and these things are called effects that will run when any of their dependencies change as a component's parent is re-rendered. We use the state to store the user's events for the week and an effect to load these events on the first render. Power Apps largely handles all time zone stuff for us, but we're bare metal here since Microsoft Graph,
one API to rule them all,
returns dates in UTC. 90% of bugs are either security or date time issues, so it's really helpful having Power Apps do much of the heavy lifting. Since we copied the Microsoft Graph,
one API to, oh, never mind,
class from the Microsoft repo, it's got a get calendar function, which is cheating, I know, but seriously, you really don't want me to type out all of that stuff. We then simply get all the events for the specific day by filtering. And it's interesting that there are similarities between PowerFX and TypeScript here in that the aim is always to write less code at a higher level as possible. I think to write code low or otherwise, you really need to be an optimist. You would just give up otherwise. I keep telling myself that I'm an optimist, and then we just go and get errors. Great timing. Debugging in the browser gives us plenty of red text to work with, so here we just need to do some null checks. PowerFX is always live, so you can see the stuff happening as you build it, which is like mind-blowing. I'm making a test event. Yes, it's Santa time right now, but it just takes me so long to make these videos. It'll probably be summertime by the time you see this. Or maybe I'll never finish it at all. Or maybe I've just forgotten to click record and I can't face recording it again and I'm just crying in the corner. Something's not quite right there. We need to span the rows for the first day cell like that. Oh no, wait, that's just worse. Let's zoom in there. It's totally lost it. one character
changes everything.
There's that voice again. Is it inside my head?
Power Apps has connectors for all the Office stuff. The connectors authenticate as the current user, and it abstracts away from the Microsoft Graph queries. It's like Graph TypeScript wrappers, but simpler and better. The IntelliSense makes it easier to discover which functions it has, and you can easily figure out without going to the docs, because that's always the last resort, right? Right? But there's a downside. There is always a trade-off, isn't there? The connectors are like a subset of graph calls. So here we can't get the default calendar like we do in React. We have to query for the one named calendar, which isn't always going to be called calendar in a multi-language situation. I guess we could use a drop-down and get the user to select it. So now we've got the events. We can bind them to a child gallery inside each parent row and add the start date of the event as a text box. So this is cool. You can use AI-driven ideas that gives you formatting code based on how you want it to look, using examples, kind of like Copilot inside VS Code. So let's take a look at that. And this is giving us scrolling galleries inside scrolling galleries. So you're likely to miss that important lunch date because it's going to be hidden. And I like to use different colored backgrounds of components to check that I've got no rogue gaps or borders when I'm calculating heights and widths of things, which obviously never happens, honest. And I can use rectangles again to put borders. And then I also need to filter the events based on the day using a date only function that I added to my component library, and do a little bit of finishing off touches on the formatting. Sometimes it can get a little bit tricky just getting all the different things to line up, but it's looking pretty good, I think.
In React, we use the router component to navigate around, just like navigating between screens in Power Apps. We're using Bootstrap here, so we add a nav link and style it like a button. And this is where React components are really easy to construct user interfaces with. They do tend to be a bit, perhaps a bit more fragile than Power Apps, but there's certainly more data binding plumbing you've got to write. And Power Apps tries to isolate you from all of that, which it does work, to be honest, most of the time. Using the React Bootstrap component, we can quickly construct a form using this declarative layout. And again, we use the component state to hold the subject, recipients, dates, etc. Whoops, I've bound both date pickers to the start date, so I need to fix that. And we add a button to create the event and cancel the form. And we use an effect to define if the new event button is enabled. It's run each time any of the fields change. That's how effects work, if you remember. And then the disabled state is passed down to the button props to actually disable that button. So that's all working. And to be honest, it's pretty simple if you've got a good sample to work from. The button on click event uses Microsoft Graph to create the calendar event. And we imported the graph library, so we know that the object shape, it makes it really easy to define all the fields using the state from the component and then pass that into the graph function to create the calendar event. And since we're using TypeScript, we can use the async keyword here without the need for callbacks, etc. Power Apps completely isolates you from all of that. So async operations look in PowerFX exactly the same as synchronous operations, which is really cool. So let's give this a go. Put a date. Put some body text in there, click create, and well, that is truly beautiful. I'm crying with emotion. There's probably no one even watching right now, so I could just like do anything and no one would notice. So back in Power Apps, we add a button that has its on select event set to navigate to the new events page. The layout stack here is making everything stack vertically automatically, which is great. And there's another layout stack here that will hold the fields in the new event page. So let's add a date time picker, and there's no time element. Why is it never easy? So let's go and create a reusable time picker. I never planned this, honestly. We can add child components for that label, date, and time control. Then add input properties for the text label, initial date, and the output date. PowerFX works with an observable date binding system. So if any of the values inside the expression changes, it reevaluates, and then any other expressions or property components that use that value are also updated, and so on and so on and so on. Obviously, you can't have an infinite loop, but it's actually using Knockout.js under the hood if you're interested. Just like the function component, there is a screen that you can test components using before you publish it. I'll also create a text field control that has a label using the same technique, so both components are in the same library. Ideally, you'd create a whole set of components and reuse them in all of your apps, or maybe just consume a library that someone else has built. There are two types of components, actually, code and canvas, and these are canvas components. Code components can even be built using React, but that's probably something for another time. So I publish that component, then import it into my app, just like I did before. form's looking good. Well, okay, well, it could do with some work, really, but I'm lowering my standards at this point. I do need to add the facility to have the labels above the fields, which I kind of forgot about. So, cue epic component build sequence. To add the validation for the create button like we did in React, but here you can see that the expression is so much simpler. It will be reevaluated when any of the fields are updated, so you can just quickly create these Excel-like expressions without worrying about state and effects and all that kind of stuff. So let's give it a go. So yeah, so this is what an error looks like in Power Apps. It handles errors for you in a sense. It shows you them easily. You can handle them manually using if error and is error. We need to use UTC as the time zone to call graph, but here Power Apps knows the time zone of the user already, so it can handle all the conversions for us. In React, set state will cause a re-render, but in PowerFX, when the input value doesn't change, because it's already empty in this case, setting the inputs to empty again won't cause the component to be updated. We have to use the reset function. There is actually other ways you can do it, of course, but because YouTube, we haven't got time. I'll update the field component so that when the reset event is raised, it can call reset down on the child fields. So I add that reset function into the onVisible of the new event form and it clears the form. I'm just so tired. All I could do is just play with the resizing of the form. And I'm back. So let's just try sharing with another user. When you log on, you have to approve that give access to your calendar to the app. And then once you give an approval, it can read all your data. So there we have it. Let's summarize a little bit. So Power Apps, 1,211 YAML lines of code. React, 664 React HTML and CSS lines of code. User interface fails, React 2, Power Apps 2. Stuff that just didn't work and I had to stroke my chin a little bit to figure it out. Power Apps, I'm going to say zero, and React, probably two, maybe more. So there is a load of stuff that we haven't considered, like ALM and versioning and source control and branching and linting and debugging, mobile apps, offline support, not to mention all the cool stuff that the Power Platform brings you, like AI. It's not really to prove that there is a winner in each case. I'm finding increasingly that I'm basically starting with low code. I'm starting with Power Apps and I'm only going into pro code and building things in React where I really need to, where I can't do it inside Power Apps, or there is some functionality that is going to really make a difference to the user interface. And using Power Apps kind of feels like React anyway, but simpler. You decide, you let me know in the comments. I'd love to hear from you. And I'm really excited to be teaming up with Microsoft Canada on their developer digital meetup tour. And I'm going to be talking about just this, on how to use low-code tools to enhance your traditional software development. It's on Tuesday, April 25th from 1 to 2 Eastern time. And you can register using the link below in the description. You can attend it live or you can get it on replay, and I'll be doing live Q&A afterwards, so I'd love to see you there. But until next time, friends, cheers.